in lieu of Jeroboam defiling the 10 nations of Israel at Bethel in the 8th month the way that he did. It is perfect in design that our Creator has funneled the timing of his wrath into the corresponding timing of Jeroboam's abomination in the 8th month the way that he has. Understanding why this is perfect in design begins with understanding why our Creator created us. He created us in order to build his eternal family from our midst. I have been speaking these past few days how Bethel means Elohim's house or the house of Elohim. Jeroboam's abomination was that he profaned Yahweh Elohim's word that he gave to us in order to build his house. And he did so at the place named Elohim's house. If you want to understand the significance of this in relation to why he is timing his wrath around the anniversary of Jeroboam's abomination, you have to first understand that Yahweh has been building his house from those who have hearkened to his word and why he gave us his word. He had his prophet Isaiah record in Isaiah 55:11, "So will my word be that proceeds out of my mouth. It will not return to me void. It will accomplish that which I purpose, and it will prosper in what I sent it to do." He sent us his word to mold and fashion us in his image. In the preceding verses, he led up to this conclusion in verses 6 through 9 when he said, "Seek Yahweh while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near to you. Let the wicked forsake his pathway, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him turn to Yahweh, and he will have compassion, and our Elohim will abundantly pardon. Because your thoughts are not my thoughts," he says, "neither are your pathways my pathway," says Yahweh. "Because as the heavens are higher than the earth, so is my pathway higher than your pathways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts." He is telling us to seek him through his pathway, and not our own pathways. He is saying that our pathways are wicked before his face. He is telling us to do so in order for our unrighteous thoughts to come into agreement with his righteous thoughts, because two cannot walk together in harmony unless they are in agreement. And he is not building his family from those who refuse to be in agreement with his righteousness. Then he tells us how this is accomplished. He says in verse 10, "In the manner that rain and the snow fall from heaven and water the earth, and before they return they cause it to bring forth and bud, so that they may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so will my word be that proceeds forth out of my mouth. It will not return to me void. It will accomplish that which I purpose, and it will prosper in what I set it to do." If you cannot see from these verses that he gave us his word to teach us his way and to teach us his righteous thoughts, you are simply being willfully blind. Back to Jeroboam and his abomination of leading Israel away from Yahweh's word at Bethel. Yahweh gave him 10 of the 12 tribes to rule over, and when he did, he told him through his prophet, he says, "And it will be, if you will hearken to all that I have commanded you, and walk in my pathway, and do that which is right in my sight, to hedge about my statutes and my commandments, like David my servant did, that I will be with you. And I will build you into a sure house, as I built David, and I will give Israel to you." But Jeroboam did not do this. He invented his own image of Elohim to worship and serve. He profaned Yahweh's word by inventing his own worship. In 1 Kings chapter 12, "And he offered up upon the altar which he had made in Bethel on the 15th day of the 8th month, in the month which he had devised," or he invented in his own wicked, uncircumcised heart. "And he made a feast to the children of Israel, and he offered upon the altar and burnt incense." Folks, I have been pounding Jeroboam's abomination at Bethel for the last few days because it explains and it testifies to the whole reason why Yahweh is sending his wrath upon you. The symbolism as to why he is sending his wrath is testified throughout his word, but it is summed up brilliantly in Jeroboam's abomination. Yahweh Elohim has been building his house from the descendants of Israel and those who chose to be engrafted into Israel. If you cannot understand this, I'll spell it out for you. 1. After Yahweh told Abram to leave his kindred, he led him to set up an altar to worship him outside of Bethel. 2. Yahweh gave Abraham's grandson Jacob the name Israel at Bethel. 3. Bethel means Elohim's house. 4. Israel means Elohim rules over, and ultimately Elohim gives rule to if he rules over them. This is pretty simple and straightforward. If Elohim is not governing you, meaning you are not hearkening to his word, you are not of Israel. Even if you are of the physical descendants of Israel, You are cut off from being his children if you are not hearkening to him. His word testifies to this plainly. 5. Yahweh is building his house from Israel, which is those who he rules over. 6. Yahweh gave Jeroboam charge over 10 of the nations of Israel and to help him continue to build his family. 7. Jeroboam moved Yahweh's feast that his word declares to be in the 7th month to the 8th month, and he profaned it. In addition to moving it to the 8th month, he profaned it further by setting up the 2 golden calves. And 8, Yahweh described his abomination as an invention of his own heart. Folks, this is not complicated. If you are not hearkening to his word, you are profaning it. It might not be your own invention like it was with Jeroboam, but if you're following one of Satan's inventions, isn't it the same thing? Our Messiah lived by his Father's word in the flesh, and he told us to follow him. Instead, nearly all of you are following the lies of Saul of Tarsus. Yahweh's word testifies to his son. It testifies that he would send him to magnify his Father's Torah, which he did. Does his word testify to your boy Saul? No, his word testifies against Saul. He says to stone anyone who seeks to take you to a different pathway. Jeroboam should have been stoned that day, and so should have Saul of Tarsus. I have had some of you write me and tell me that Yahweh was not going to let an impostor into his word, therefore you say that Saul's writings are true. Your claim is that Yahweh preserved his word through what is called the Bible today. Yahweh did preserve his word, but he never said that he was going to preserve it in a book that was determined and put together by a bunch of whores who were rebellious to his word. His word declares that those who put together what is called the Bible are of the mother whore of Babylon. Where did he say that he was going to rise up a bunch of whores who lived in rebellion to his word to preserve it? No, he commanded us to guard and to hedge about his word. He commanded us to do this over and over again in his word. Abraham was found in his favor because Abraham hearkened to my voice, he says, and guarded and held fast to my commandments and my statutes and my Torah. There are 2 Hebrew words that are used over and over again in his scriptures that are associated with his commandments and his statutes and judgments that are found in his Torah. They are the Hebrew words Shamar and Mishmareth. Both of them are used in this verse. Shamar is typically translated as you shall keep or you shall observe or kept. It is used 468 times. The Strong's Concordance says that it means to hedge about or to guard. The word Mishmareth is used 78 times. It is typically translated the charge of. The Strong's Concordance says that it means to watch as in a sentry or a post, or objectively as a preservation or an observing in the sense of a duty or an office. The 2 words are often used together like they are in this verse, and the King James sometimes translated them as keeping the charge of when used together, and this is not a bad translation. In any case, both words carry the meaning of guarding or hedging about or preserving. The reason why Yahweh commanded us to guard or to hedge about or to preserve his commandments and his statutes and judgments so many times is because he is building his house through them. Building his house is his family business, and he wants us involved in his family business. He is telling us to guard or hedge about his house. This is what a family does. We're supposed to guard Bethel, not profane it. We're supposed to help one another, including our children, get into his house. We're not supposed to help lead one another, including our children, to another pathway that leads to the lake of fire. All other pathways other than his pathway, which is his word, lead to the lake of fire. He also told us to guard or to hedge about or to preserve his appointed times, like his Sabbaths that are part of his pathway. Have you done this? Are you doing this? I'll put the instructions up again where that were given to Jeroboam, 1 Kings 11, and it will be if you will hearken to all that I have commanded you and walk in my pathway and do that which is right in my sight, to hedge about my statutes and my commandments, like my David my servant did, that I will be with you and I will build you into a sure house, as I built David, and I will give Israel to you. Doing these things builds us into his sure house. If you cannot see the symbolism in this that is associated with the here and the now in lieu of Jeroboam profaning Israel back then at Bethel, then you are simply choosing to not see it. Israel is those whom Yahweh is building his house from. And Where Jeroboam accomplished his abomination is of huge significance in this. It is at the place where Yahweh named after his house. All roads lead back to profaning Yahweh's house. And profaning that which he sent to build his house, which is his word, is the same thing as profaning his house. The prophecies that have unfolded the way that they have and funneled into the 7-day period of Jeroboam's profane feast and into the 42 days that follow it are phenomenal. For those of you who are choosing to keep your heads buried in the sand, he is suggesting that you pull them out quickly because the anniversary of Jeroboam's feast begins in less than 5 days now. The evidence that he has given to us with the sign of Jonah and the 2 30-day prophecies that are found in Hosea and Zechariah that testify to November 9th is pretty impossible to refute if you believe his word. But the evidence is his word, and his word is not good enough for most of you. You want fireworks and bells and whistles instead. But you lie to yourselves, because even a miracle like our Messiah walking out of the tomb 3 days and three nights after he's put there was not enough of a bell and a whistle to cause you to follow him. Following him is hearkening to his father like he did. Instead, you followed wolves in sheep's clothing who taught you to rebel against the Most High like Israel did back then when they followed Jeroboam's rebellion. Instead of stoning him, look at this verse on the screen. Have you hearkened to all that he commanded us? Are you hearkening to everything that he commanded us? Are you walking in his pathway? His pathway is his Torah. Do you do that which is right in his sight, to hedge about or to preserve his statutes and his commandments like David his servant did, the man who was after his own heart, meditated on his word day and night? He says if you are, then he will be with you and build you into a sure house, as he built David, and he will give Israel to you. Doing so is guarding or hedging about his house. It is preserving his house. And if you are not, then dying you will die in your rebellion to him and to why he created you. Thus saith Yahweh Elohim.